week on the Brody File, peace on earth? Hardly when it comes to the evangelical movement. Where's the kumbaya? We go in search of it. Former Clinton Press Secretary Mike McCurry is here.
Is civility possible in this between evangelicals? Peace on earth?
I think it is if we sit and really get to know each other.
On the conservative side, also here, Dr. Richard Land in studio, along with President Bush's former speechwriter Michael Gerson, who wonders what's happened to President Obama's outreach to evangelicals.
Over time, Americans have become less clear about the president's religious views and religious values.
You'll also hear Brody File interviews from Franklin Graham, Ralph Reed, Jim Wallace, and Hillary Clinton.
My faith has sustained me, it has informed me, it has saved me.
Plus, what would Jesus do? A topic-by-topic look at the hot-button issues of today. Get ready for this week's Brody File. Can the evangelical movement come together and find peace on earth? And Merry Christmas, everybody. Can I say that? Yes, of course I can. Welcome to this very merry ho-ho-ho edition of the Brody File. You know, when it comes to the evangelical movement, you have conservatives, moderates, progressives, all with very different priorities when it comes to public policy. And the Bible, well, Scripture is quoted by all sides to make their point.
So I want to start with Genesis 8, verse 21 and 22.
Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of my brethren, you did for me.
Woe to you because you load people down with burdens they can hardly carry, and you yourselves will not lift a finger to help them.
What would Jesus do?
So now, before introducing our panel, we want to get you in the right frame of mind for this show.
Kumbaya, my Lord, kumbaya.
Gather around, everyone, as we do our best to sing kumbaya and find some common ground here on the Brody File. Now, our panel, who will not be singing for us, but rather impart loads of wisdom. Michael Gerson is here, former speechwriter for President George W. Bush, an op-ed columnist for the Washington Post, and the co-author of the new book, City of Man, Religion and Politics in a New Era. And Richard Land also here as well. Dr. Land is president of the Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission, a nationally syndicated radio host, and author of the book, here's the long title, The Divided States of America, What Liberals and Conservatives Are Missing in the God and Country Shouting Match. Gentlemen, both of you, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Good to be with you.
I appreciate it. All right.
Merry
so,
Christmas.
Well, Merry, I'm glad you said it. Listen, 30 seconds or less. Good luck. Michael Gerson, how can evangelicals, from a common ground perspective, come together on public policy? Is it even possible, or should we not even be framing it that way?
Well, in the new book that I worked on, The City of Man, we try to make the case that Christians need to be careful not to be tools in somebody else's power game, whether it's the Tea Party or the religious left, okay? They have to bring a unique set of perspectives. And the basic element of that perspective is a view of human dignity, of the importance of the individual as it created in God's image, that applies to, in my view, to the unborn, to the poor in the inner city, and to the African child with AIDS in Africa. Mm-hmm. And that consistent viewpoint is the unique Christian contribution and something we should be able to rally around.
Dr. Land, what do you think?
Well, I would say ditto to that. You know, Christianity, everywhere Christianity has gone, the plight of the common man and of individual human beings has been tremendously pushed forward and been a tremendous amount of progress. You know, the Declaration of Independence is basically based on Judeo-Christian values. We believe that all human beings, we are all created equal, and we're endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights. You know, among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So, and indeed, the abortion issue, the euthanasia issue, you know, care in the middle of life, the poor in Africa, the poor here at home, all of those are the concerns of Christians.
Let's work our way through some of these hot-button issues. We like to call it, what would Jesus do? You know, it's an evangelical thing. First up, healthcare. Gentlemen, I want you to have a look at this ad. It's by the Progressive American Values Network. It's about healthcare.
For 8 days in August, thousands of uninsured Americans waited to receive treatment at a free health clinic. They are among the millions of Americans who wait for healthcare reform. They are not numbers or statistics, They are God's children, and they have a face. While the politicians bear false witness about reform, they wait.
That's part of the clip. Clearly, that resonates, I would think, among evangelicals, but then abortion tripped a lot of this debate up that we saw. What is your take as it relates to this whole health care and abortion debate, and health care maybe overall, Michael?
Well, this is a particularly good example. I mean, I think it is a Christian moral value to say that people need health care and to remind people that this is a basic issue of human rights. Mm-hmm. But that's very, very different from saying a certain policy mm-hmm. is the best way to achieve that. Christians differed significantly on that issue. And those are not moral debates or biblical debates. They're actually policy debates. Mm-hmm. What works best? That's what right. actually serves people? Same was true with the welfare debate or mm-hmm. other things. It's not just a matter of good intentions.
It's a question of what works. It's a question of, what is the prudential answer of what works?
I want to kind of move a little bit, somewhat rapid fire, through the economy. I want you to listen to conservative Ralph Reed and also the progressive Jim Wallis. They sound very similar if you listen to what they're saying about the economy and morality, greed, Wall Street. Have a listen.
If you don't have people, David, who operate according to the golden rule, and according to basic internal values of right and wrong, you end up with things like the crisis on Wall Street, which was not just a fiscal crisis, let's be clear. It was also a crisis of a lot of people gaming the system, a lot of people over-leveraging in debt, violating a lot of basic biblical principles of a sound economy.
How did we get to the place where our cultural maxims are things like, greed is good, it's all about me, and I want it now. Those kinds of maxims have consequences for an economy, for a culture, for our children, for our values.
Michael Gerson, isn't this an area where it seems like progressives and evangelicals might find some common ground? Greed, corruption, Wall Street?
There's really no system so perfect that people don't need to be good. And that is an emphasis Christians need to bring on capitalism. Free markets are the best way to organize a productive society that rewards effort and enterprise. I completely agree with that. But even free markets can fail if individuals don't have the values that make them possible. But
capitalists are sinful too. Capitalists are greedy too. So you have to have a system of checks and balances, and you have to reward morality and punish immorality.
Let me ask you about poverty real quick. You know, we hear so much about this fight against poverty, but conservatives really don't make this an issue as much as the progressives do, at least. And you would think we would be, overall, assistance to poor people mm-hmm. to help them out a little bit, but then government intervention gets involved a little bit. So let me play mm-hmm. a clip from David Beckman, the president of the Bread for World, who talked about government intervention. Take a listen to this.
Churches and charities can't do it all. We can't food bank our way to the end of hunger. So food banking, helping our neighbor in need, that is really important. But we've also got to get our powerful government to do its part. I have yet to meet a voter. I have yet to meet a politician who says, you know, I don't care about hungry kids. We all do. So there are some things that we can do so we don't have one in four kids in this country running out of food. The binding constraint is will, political will especially, to reduce hunger and poverty. And I think that political will can come out of the hearts of people who've experienced God's love in Jesus.
I think the most creative public policy is for government, instead of providing those services themselves through bureaucracies, to find ways to empower individuals and communities to provide those services. Mm. That's kind of a middle ground in this debate. You can hurt with the helping hand. It's really possible. That's why you need good policies, creative policies in this area, but you do need public responses.
All right, I want to take a quick break. We're going to talk about immigration when we come back, but also a look at President Obama's relationship with evangelicals, or lack thereof. Also a look at how the faith-based office is doing under President Obama. Back in a moment.
Yeah, buddy.
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
The 700 Club. See it as never before. The stories, the places, the people. The 700 Club, now in HD. We'll take you to India, China, Africa, Thailand, and across the USA. So close, you'll feel as though you were there. Look into the eyes of the people you've helped and see the hope you've given them. Experience what God is doing in the world today in high definition. The 700 Club, now in HD.
And welcome back, everybody, to the Brody File. Michael Gerson, Richard Land back with us. Guys, let me ask you, immigration. Richard Land, let me start with you. You've taken some hits from conservatives on this.
I have.
Is that an understatement? Where is the evangelical movement, would you say, on this immigration debate as it relates to going forward from here? Mm-hmm. Can there be progress made at the end of the day?
I think the evangelical movement as a whole is much like the country. They're ahead of their leaders. There is a solution out there, a grand compromise. We need to give people an opportunity to come forward and to agree that they've broken the law and they're going to be punished for it by paying a fine and by going to the back of the line. They get to stay in the country, but they're on probation. They go to the back of the line behind those who are trying to come here legally, and they work through a probationary period. We're not going to deport 12 million people. And so it's better to find a constructive way, once we've got control of the border and control of the workplace, mm-hmm. to allow these folks to work their way toward full legal status.
Let me move on real quick, Michael, because I want to get your take on this next subject. It's President Obama's relationship with conservative evangelicals, or at least those evangelicals that he reached out to in 2008. This is what you wrote about the president's effort. Quote, as a candidate, it was a measure of Barack Obama's political innovation and ambition that he set out to win religious voters, including evangelical Christians. As president, his failure in this effort is equally revealing. And Franklin Graham hasn't been too pleased either. I interviewed him a little while back. Here's what he had to say. Take a listen to this.
There were millions of evangelical Christians that voted for Barack Obama in this last election. I don't think they will be at the table next time. I think they've seen things from this administration that concern them, worry them.
Michael, this has been a big concern of yours. I know you've written about this.
Right. Well, it's a concern basically because expectations were raised during the last election. There was an unprecedented outreach from the Democratic Party, who looked at the exit returns of the last election and discovered religion in America. Okay, and a tremendous outreach. But the extraordinary situation here is that over time, Americans have become less clear about the president's religious views and religious values. There was more certainty about mm-hmm. what they were when he was elected than there is 2 years later. I think it's because he doesn't talk about them often. It doesn't seem to inform his public policy very much. He doesn't speak in effective language on this, which is what he did during the campaign, which is why it's confusing.
Richard, what do you think? What's the heartland saying about this?
Well, I think there's I know a lot of people who are evangelicals who are very disappointed, especially some who voted for the president, and who expected more. They expected this. The faith-based office was given expanded authority and expanded purview over what it had had under President Bush. If a Republican president, if a conservative president had given the kind of purview to the faith-based office that Obama did, the ACLU would have been screaming until they would have had to have vocal cord surgery. And yet, nothing's happened. I mean, it's been, they present reports, and nothing happens.
They're marginal. They're irrelevant to the way the administration does its main work. They're just not central to the message, and I think people recognize that.
Interesting. Let me play you a clip from my interview with Joshua Dubois, the head of the faith-based office, here just a little bit ago. Take a listen.
We are fundamentally shifting what the faith-based office is all about. The previous office largely focused on making sure that faith-based organizations received their share of federal grants, so they focused on dollars for the most part. Our focus is instead on issues and on impact in individual communities, how we can resource and help local nonprofits, including faith-based groups, have an impact on specific issues. And that's subtle, but it's a fundamental shift.
Michael?
I think a little too subtle. I think that there's very little measurable impact there. I was a member of the senior White House staff during the Bush administration. The faith-based office had a place at the table in the consultations of the senior staff on important issues. That's not true in this current administration. They're very marginal.
But that wouldn't be the impression initially when he took office that we thought we were going to get from this faith-based office.
No. I mean, if you look at the purview they were given, it was expanded. I mean, their charter was very much expanded considering what it had been under Bush, where it was much more narrowly focused. You're absolutely right. I was there with some of those meetings took place, and the president was, he made it very clear the presidential authority was behind the faith-based office in the Bush administration. But in the Obama administration, they were given this expanded purview, and then they were sort of sent off to do their thing, and they received the reports, but there's no emphasis, there's no follow-through. I know people who served on that advisory committee who have been very, very frustrated at the lack of ability to get the president's attention.
Michael Gerson, Dr. Land, thank you both very much.
Great.
For
Great
being
to be with
here.
You.
Appreciate it, guys. When we come back, the progressive side, a chat with former Clinton press secretary Mike McCurry. Back in a moment.
From the world's leading Christian news operation, a groundbreaking step that brings you national, international news and analysis at your fingertips. The CBN News Channel. For the first time ever, you get the benefits of a full-time news channel from the renowned CBN News team, 24/7 on the web. CBN News Channel provides a new platform by delivering CBN News to a larger audience through the latest technology.
News viewers have made it clear they're dissatisfied with their choices. They want news without a spin.
CBN News Channel answers that need.
With a trustworthy alternative that's easy to find, easy to watch, any time of the day.
CBNNewsChannel.com, 24/7 on the web.
And welcome back, everybody, to the Brody File. We're now joined by a very special guest. You may remember him from the Clinton years. Yes, the man behind the podium, dealing with that pesky press, all those people, and answering those fun questions, former press secretary for President Clinton, Mike McCurry. Mike, thank you for being here.
Great to be with you.
And let me talk to you a little bit about this whole idea of common ground. We hear that phrase all the time in evangelical circles. And I talked to Tony Perkins earlier, and he talked a little bit about these progressive evangelicals and what he believes some of their motives are and where they're coming from, at least their point of view. Take a listen and look at the monitor here. Take a look.
When liberal Christians talk about social justice, they talk about working that social justice through the government. Scripture doesn't point to that. It points to individual responsibility. And I think Arthur Brooks has written a great book about this, Who Really Cares? And it talks about the benefits that follow actually helping your fellow man. Those benefits are absent when you do it through government.
Mike, it seems that the government intervention seems to be a major sticking point between both sides. What's your sense on that?
Well, you know, we need government for many things, among other things, to kind of keep us secure, to protect us from external threats, to help us live in the kind of communities that we want to have. So I think Tony's a little bit wrong there. The tool of government is what we have to use prudently to help us when we need help. Mm-hmm. I don't disagree with him that individual action, and particularly individual action based on our faith, what we do to reach out to the least, the last, the lost, what Matthew 25 calls us to do to take care of those who are homeless, in need, and who, you know, really want us to respond as a community. That is kind of how many of us on the progressive left see the tool of government.
There is a segment of the show that we did earlier. We call it the Kumbaya section.
Kumbaya, my Lord.
Where, you know, can we not just all hold hands and, to quote, I guess, the philosopher Rodney King from the LA riots, can we all just get along? But tell me a little bit when it comes to common ground. Where are some areas that evangelicals from conservative to progressive can actually make a difference and come together?
I think when it comes to poverty and attacking the root causes of poverty globally and in our own communities, there's a lot of work that's being done by Christian evangelicals on the right, by progressives on the left, to say, look, there's an agenda there that we agree that we have to address together because we are called to take care of those who are poor. Protecting God's creation, You know, this is a beautiful world that we've created. And I think increasingly we see in wanting to protect this planet and coming together around things that we can do to make sure that we don't destroy the fragile nature of our ecosystems, we see some real commonality there between right and left, where some things that we can do to work together. Mm-hmm. I think when it comes to peace, how do we advance, you know, a world in which we free ourselves of war, that we truly are the blessed peacemakers that we are called to be by mm-hmm. Scripture. I think there are some things that unite us there.
The one that's always around is abortion. I mean, well, and where do you go on that?
And it is there, and it will be there, and I think that's important to name the differences that we have there. There's no question to me that people who, in good faith, believe that life begins at conception mm-hmm. and who think that it is an abomination, in fact, murder, for abortion to occur, have to make the moral case stridently that we have to end all abortions. I think those of us who are not as sure of when, you know, God gives us that divine spark, who maybe have a more tolerant view of the question of abortion and see from the perspective of the woman that sometimes that's the only awful choice that's available, we take the position, all right, we want to work to make abortion, as we said in the Clinton years, safe, legal, and rare. Mm-hmm. And I would actually put rare at the top of that list.
You know, Democrats talked a lot about these issues in 2008. I mean, you had Barack Obama, and you had a lot of these faith forums. Hillary Clinton was out there, and I actually interviewed Hillary Clinton as it relates to her faith. And she talked at length, good 45 minutes or so, about faith and politics and some of the personal difficulties during that time. Here's a little bit about her faith. Take a listen to this.
My faith has sustained me, it has informed me, it has saved me, it has chided me, it has challenged me, and I don't know who I would be or where I would be had I not been given that gift of those, you know, years of, you know, tutelage through my faith.
I've seen her at some moments of extreme pain, caused, frankly, by the behavior of her husband. And I know how much her faith sustained her in those moments and gave her the capacity for forgiveness, gave her a sense of her duty to family, mm-hmm. Things that I think that we cherish, whether we're conservatives or liberals. And I think that's a very genuine expression of faith. Democrats have a hard time talking about these things.
Right.
It's a very curious thing. I think that's because in the conservative evangelical traditions, professing your faith and witnessing comes much more naturally. And I think for the liberal mainstream Protestants, Hillary, like me, we're both Methodists, mm-hmm. I think that the ability and capacity to talk about our faith in an open way like that is diminished because it's not part of the way in which our religious tradition actually operates in the world. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a problem. That's one of the things, by the way, that I continually tell my Democratic friends in politics. Be open. People want to see a little bit about who we are. What is our character? What is the nature of how we feel God calls us to behave in the world? Some of these questions that we were just talking about. What do we see as the role of government from a moral point of view? These are very important questions.
When we come back, well, we have a few more minutes left with Mike McCurry here. We are going to take a quick break, and we've got some more questions. Back in a moment.
Daddy?
Yeah, buddy?
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
The 700 Club. See it as never before. The stories, the places, the people. The 700 Club. Now in HD. We'll take you to India, China, Africa, Thailand, and across the USA. So close, you'll feel as though you were there. Look into the eyes of the people you've helped and see the hope you've given them. Experience what God is doing in the world today in high definition. The 700 Club. Now in HD.
All right, we're back now for our remaining moments with former Clinton press secretary Mike McCurry. Mike, you know, you've seen these polls. I know you have. They're out there. About 1 in 5 Americans, we're going to put up a graphic here, 1 in 5 Americans, about 18%, think President Obama's a Muslim. Now, that percentage was 11% in 2009. It's now up to 18%. It keeps going up. I know you shake your head on this. I get that. I know a lot of Democrats shake their head on this. But you would think politically, at least. I mean, if you're in the White House, you know, you got to be going... It's easy to blow it off, but at the same time, what do you do?
I'd say 1 in 5 people probably think the moon is made of green cheese, too. But, you know, look, there are people who just won't want to believe anything positive about Barack Obama, and 20% is probably an accurate number. There are just people who are Obama haters, and just like there were people who were Bill Clinton haters, just like there were people who were George Bush haters. I think any good political operation has to look beyond that. Now, I do think... It's hard for Barack Obama to, if you're not actively involved in a worship experience every Sunday here in Washington when you're in town, it's hard to not, you know, you don't see those pictures of the president walking to church, you know, going with his family. Now, he is devout and worships regularly as a faithful Christian. He's very close to the chaplain at Camp David where his family spends a lot of weekends. In future programs, you're going to have all the candidates who are going to run for president against Obama on the Republican side probably here on this program, and you'll ask them, what does religion mean to them? I think it's a fair question, and I think President Obama will answer that too. But there will always be a percentage that just won't get it.
Won't get it. All right, let me ask you one last thing before we let you go. You wrote this back in 2008. This is a quote from you about the president, a little bit about holding his feet to the fire to agree on some faith issues. Quote, President Obama will need to fulfill promises he made to care about those who suffer at home and around the world. The media and conventional pundits may not know that Obama pledged to end childhood hunger in America by 2015, but a lot of religious people will remember. Those who have volunteered as missions to the poor in developing lands will remember Obama's promise to double foreign assistance. Those who believe that humankind is uniquely endowed by a creator God to be stewards of that creation will watch very carefully to see what the new administration does to meet pledges on global climate change. And probably most important, all faith communities believe that war is a violence against God's promise of shalom, and ending the violence of war in favor of the diplomacy of peace will be a critical measure. How's he doing so far?
Well, we're still watching.
Yeah.
I think on a lot of those things, you have to say it's incomplete. And we know the reasons why. We know there's extreme pressure around budget. There's a lack of consensus and sometimes about how we ought to spend scarce federal resources.
In 10 seconds or less, is civility possible in this between evangelicals? Peace on earth?
I think it is if we sit and really get to know each other and listen. It's awfully tough to demonize someone that you pray with. And I think that bringing us together so that we can reflect on what our values are and what we are guided to by God and by Scripture, I think that's another way to help us.
Real pleasure for you coming in. Thank you so much. Mike McCurry, not at the press podium, at this podium or whatever this is, a table. Thank you, Mike.
Great being here.
Appreciate it. That's it for this week on The Brody File. We do hope you have a very Merry Christmas. We're back with new shows and newsmakers after the first of the year. Until then, God bless. Have a wonderful holiday.